When you watch D News or other awesome science shows, people say this paper, a new study, researchers, or a team from, but how much money do we have to spend to get that science? Sup nerds, Trace here for D News. Science and money have always had a contentious relationship. Alexander Graham Bell borrowed money from the parents of a wealthy student to help create the harmonic telegraph. Science needs capital, which can often mean a trip to the Capitol. But come on, who really pays for science? First, how much are we talking? It depends on your lab, the university, your company, the type of science. Getting telescope time is not the same as finding and tracking thousands of participants for a 10-year-long study, but here's one example. Let's say you're hired at an average university's biology department. You're gonna have to be doing research there, so you negotiate what is called a startup fund, which could be, say, $400,000. Wow, that's a ton of moolah! But it's actually not, we've just started. From there, researchers need equipment, staff, consumable products like pipettes, petri dishes, beakers, plus bits and bobs for every stage of the experiment. To get money for all of that stuff, scientists have to apply for grants. I asked Dr. Joe Hansen of PBS's It's Okay to Be Smart, a biologist, and he said, for biomedical science, the gold standard of research grants is the National Institutes of Health R01 grant, which could be like $400,000 or $500,000. Looking into it, there were 2,100 applicants and only 294 were awarded in 2015. That's about a 14% award rate. So between startup funds and a big grant, you might have $800K or $900K. That sounds like a lot, but even that can't cover everything. Plus, the university takes a cut of whatever scientists win, sometimes as much as 50%. This is why scientists spend so much of their time applying for grants. Science is really expensive and time-consuming, and funding has to be in place before a single bit of research can be started. As Scientific American wrote, scientists spend too much time raising cash instead of doing experiments. So where does this money come from? Most science is funded by governments. In the US, it can come from the National Institutes of Health, the National Science Foundation, Defense Department, Department of Education, or even the Fish and Wildlife Service. I mean, that's what the government does, right? It collects taxes and distributes that money for the good of us all. But since the 2008 Great Recession and 2010 sequestration, you remember that little ditty? Science's funding has dipped significantly. This can mean fewer studies, fewer discoveries, and fewer breakthroughs. Government monies are dispersed through grants, offices, contracts, and programs, but though most of the money comes from the government, they're not alone at the table when the bill for scientific research gets developed and dropped. Lately, private companies have been paying for more science, which can be controversial. More than 75% of all clinical trials in medicine are funded by private companies. The controversy comes when the gal footing the bill has a vested interest in certain results. Think drug or tobacco companies. But not all private money is bad. Some private studies are partnerships with government grants, public universities, nonprofits, or foundations. And in an ideal world, it wouldn't matter who paid for it. It would all just be science. Ideal world. Since the 1970s, when it peaked at 2% of GDP, the US has spent less and less on research and development. According to the American Association for the Advancement of Science, we're now spending about 0.78% of our GDP on research. Most of that is from the government, but these days, some scientists are even looking to the internet and crowdfunding to pay for their experiments, and that's just a whole other monster. Think of all the stories and science and stuff we've talked about here on D News, and the number of times you've been blown away by a new healthcare technology, an advance in space travel, or a paleontological discovery. Those things were expensive, and they were hard fought. It just makes me love them more. The research to do this video was super fun. I got neck deep into the budgets and excitement of science around the world. I went way into it. I like to say the more I know about something, the more I want to know about something. Take something we all love, movies. Did you know a preacher created flexible celluloid or why we use 24 frames per second? What about how your brain sees all those still frames as one moving image? That's what my podcast show is about. Over there, I go all in on whatever science topic I can, and last week I looked at the history, science, and future of movies. Check it out. Let me know what you think. If you like that other channel, please subscribe. I'll love you forever. Or if you prefer to stick with D News, NASA moves money around all the time to contractors and grant winners. But what would happen if we doubled NASA's budget? You know, just doubled it, or tripled it, whatever. I looked into this more over on this video. If money were no object, NASA could invest heavily in developing new technology. They could, say, maintain the ISS after 2024 when it's slated to be abandoned, and fund the human spaceflight program. Right now, it's either or. How much of our GDP should we spend on science? Let us know down in the comments. Make sure you subscribe right here on YouTube. Thanks for watching D News.